every day for us, the citizens of Glasgow, and I appreciate that. However, just as your grandmother told you years and years ago, it only takes a few bad apples to spoil the whole bunch. And I'm afraid that that's the reputation that we currently have. We are continually in the news that the residents of Glasgow don't need to continue to be embarrassed or to be afraid of those that are sworn to protect them. We need consistent leadership throughout the department and throughout the city. And once we have those issues addressed, I think we can quit worrying about the day-to-day things that bite us in the behind, and let's move on to the bigger issues, which again are economic development and drawing industry and jobs to our community. The IDEA board is the method through which we do that for the most part. They have several workforce initiatives that they are working on. We need to continue to support those to move that forward. Our spec building program is a proven method for bringing industry into the community. We need to continue that program. That program doesn't need to be reinvented every 2 years. We need to put something in place to ensure that we have a spec building ready when clients are looking to locate in Glasgow.
Would you like to respond?
Yes, I would. I'm pleased to have the opportunity to address the issues at the police department. It has been, we have had some issues at the police department. Everyone knows that. I knew what the issues were when I came into office. Mr. Doty has made it a number one issue in his campaign, yet at the same time he's been quoted in the paper as saying he didn't really know what the issues were, and he wouldn't know really until he had a chance to get inside the department. I know what the issues are. We've had some officers who have made some very bad personal choices, and that has reflected badly on the department as a whole. However, my administration has worked very hard to address those issues under the laws and the requirements that we have that are set by the state legislature, and we've had some successes, and I'm very proud of the improvements that we have made in the police department.
Thank you. That was raised on several of the questions that were returned, and it is coincidentally the next question that that is here. Dick, you will be responding to this first, and could be you've said what you have to say about it, but the question is, the Glasgow Police Department has had extensive publicity in the past several years, some good, some bad. Do you have praise or approval for the current operation of the GPD? Do you intend to make any changes in leadership or operations in the next 4 years? And I want to explain something else to the two candidates, and that is that some of these questions tend to be a little lengthy. Mm-hmm. If when it's your turn to respond, you don't remember what I'll contain, I'll be glad to repeat.
Okay,
so go ahead if you have anything further to say, Dick.
I do have a little further to say. Again, the citizens have been embarrassed. That has been an issue for us for many, many months now. And that does not need to be the case. They don't need to be afraid of those that are sworn to protect them. Once again, there are many, many good officers there within that department, and they need to be praised for putting their life on the line each and every day. However, they do need some consistent leadership, and that leadership begins at the mayor's office and works its way right on down through the leadership of the police department itself. Again, I think that the residents deserve better. They expect better, and under my leadership, I think we will begin to see those changes being made to move us forward. As Rhonda said, I have said in the past that I would like to get inside the police department before we make too many decisions. The reason being, anything I know and have heard of the police department has either been in the newspaper or from hearsay. Until you get inside that department, I don't think you know what the issues actually are. Now, I have sat on several personnel hearings recently, and I think that would be considered first-hand experience, and can say that we do have some personnel issues there, so I can speak to those. Again, there are some in that department that don't need to be in that department. We have heard time and again that you can't do anything with the police department because of their Bill of Rights, and that's just not the case. If, in fact, the policeman's Bill of Rights was so restrictive, why would other cities in our neighborhood be able to deal with their police officers, and yet we can't? So we can work around that. It just takes consistent leadership and consistent discipline to work with the officers that are causing the issues in our community.
Right. Well, there, disciplinary action in the police department is a complicated matter. And I can answer why sometimes we can't handle it the way the other cities in our area handle it, because we are classified as a third-class city. We operate under very specific rules, which say, under the KRS that is called the Officer Bill of Rights, I have to, as the mayor, recommend disciplinary action to the city council. I don't have the right, as the mayor, like I do in other departments, with the exception of the fire department, I cannot discipline and I cannot terminate or take any action, demote an officer, without it going before the city council. The only way that you can do that is if that officer is approached with the disciplinary action, and for example, you say, we have proven that you have violated this policy in the department. We are recommending a 2-week suspension as a disciplinary action. If that officer agrees to that and takes that discipline and admits their wrongdoing, you don't have to go before the city council. You can also get rid of officers by that same action. If you tell them the evidence you have against them, they may take the opportunity to resign. And that has happened in our department. There is at least one officer that resigned under pressure, knowing that I was getting ready to take him before the city council and recommend termination. It's a long process, it's a complicated process, but you have to follow the rules and you have to follow the laws, because they are in place and it's specific and it's different depending on the classification of city that you're in. We are a third class city and we have to abide by the rules of the third class city.
Thank you. Anything further, Dick?
Again, we're not the only third class city in the state of Kentucky. Those rules do apply to other people and they seem to make those work. Again, the city council is a reasonable group of people that you all have elected. They do in fact know how to discipline. They do in fact know right from wrong. So if we consistently bring those cases before them and present those cases in a consistent manner, they'll make the right decision.
I'm going to show my ignorance here, but are both of you members of the IDEA board? Obviously you would be, just simply because you're the mayor.
I'm a non-voting member. We don't have any council members on the IDEA board.
Okay.
We had a non-voting, Mr. Marion was our non-voting member.
All right. The next question relates to the IDEA board. That's why I wanted that straight, so that the audience could be aware. What is, and this is directed to you first, Mayor. What is the mission of the IDEA board? Is it meeting that mission? If you believe it is not meeting it, what do you suggest to redirect it? If you believe that it is meeting its mission, what has been your connection or direction for accomplishing that mission?
Well, the IDEA board is charged with economic development. We have the economic development, the director of that, Dan Iacone, heads that group, and we have a board that participates in developing policy and strategies. We are fortunate in the city of Glasgow to also have some incentives that we are able to work with IDEA directly by offering incentives through IDEA to help recruit companies to the city of Glasgow. My role there is to coordinate that. When Mr. Iacone comes to me and says, Frankfurt has called and they're bringing someone down, we need to meet, we need to show them what we have available, what kind of incentives can we offer them. And I will tell them, well, within the GEDL loan fund, which is the Glasgow Economic Development Loan Fund, we have some money, how many jobs are they gonna bring, and we'll make that arrangement to offer them the loan as an incentive. So that is a unique thing that we have locally that other cities don't have. So I do believe that they are doing a good job in helping diversify our job base. As I mentioned, we went to over 14% unemployment in the recession, and part of that was we were heavily dominated by automobile manufacturing. We have been, in the past 4 or 5 years, bringing in other non-traditional manufacturing and other types of jobs that, if we ever go through a recession again, hopefully it won't hit us as hard. So they have done a great job doing that. We are in the process, just took bids on a spec building. It was something that I have encouraged them to do. We are working very hard to get that underway, and I believe that will be another incentive for people to come and look at Glasgow as an employment opportunity, and I'm proud that we are getting that underway and commend them for taking that on.
As I've said earlier, the ID Board is the means by which we attract industries and businesses to town, and I think they do a fine job with that. I think Dan and his board do a wonderful job. Those are dedicated guys and ladies that spend their time trying to draw them in. One thing that I think that they will tell you pretty quickly is that they could use some new funding. Some years ago, we stopped funding the GDL, which is a loan fund that we put together. It was a 0.5% of our tax going into that fund, and we chose to stop that when we got to about $1 million. They will tell you now that had they had more money in the past, we could have been more effective at drawing jobs here. We currently fund that at a rate of $55,000 a year. The county kicks in another $60,000 a year. And if you think about it, that will probably cover just about their operating expenses and nothing else. The spec building program that the IDEA Board is engaging in now is effective. It's been proven to be effective here in our own community, and it's been effective in our neighboring communities. Warren County, I think, has put in 4 spec buildings in 4 years, each of which have been filled immediately, and they're working on their 5th. So that does work. We have been lacking in getting our second spec building built here. It's been 2 or 3 years since Fortis moved into the building that we built. That was an effective move for us. The building was occupied within a year and a half of us taking ownership of that. So that program works. But again, they will tell you that they need more money. If we truly say that our biggest opportunity in Glasgow is jobs and recruiting industries, then let's fund it like we mean it. We fund so many other things, the plaza at $130,000 a year, jobs $55,000. We just voted to build a bicycle trail in Glasgow. $200,000 is our portion of that project, $55,000 for economic development. So again, let's put our money where our mouth is. Please don't misunderstand me. I love the plaza. I support the plaza. I love riding a bicycle, but
okay,
we need to put our money where our mouth is.
And I need to, before you get your minute of response, I want each of you to address this because it's a question that a lot of people have regarding the incentives that are given. It has appeared, based on some companies that have packed up and moved on to another place that's going to give them an incentive, that the incentive has minimal value. It gets them here, but what can you do to keep them here? Since we are talking about the GEDL incentives.
Okay, but can I respond to something?
You'll get the opportunity to do that.
Oh, okay.
This is just another.
Oh, okay.
This is within that same context.
Oh, okay.
I can respond.
But is it my question, you mean?
It's not really a question. It's more of a clarification.
Oh, okay.
From
what we can do to keep businesses here is to maintain a business-friendly environment. And that's a combination of the incentives that I've talked about, also a reasonable property tax rate, other things that when they call and ask, what do we have to offer, we can tell them we have sufficient infrastructure, we have sufficient water services, we can accommodate a company coming in needing an extra 500 or 5 million gallons of water a day. We have that infrastructure in place. A lot of cities don't have that infrastructure, and because they've let it either not expanded or it's in disrepair. We have worked very hard over the last, in my administration, working with the water company and the EPB to make sure our infrastructure is in place. We have an $8 million upgrade going on right now at our wastewater treatment plant. We are putting in new water lines on a daily basis. That's a big incentive that a lot of other cities do not have. They're not prepared to have those big companies come in. Regarding the companies that have left, or the one in particular that left that had an incentive loan, they are paying that back. And that was, I worked with that company immediately when they notified us that they were leaving, and they are doing it for economic reasons only and just relocating this company.